estate is a wealth builder. Part of our wealth, our package was real estate, still is. Yeah. We just had a meeting with our financial guy, and the real estate, it's so amazing on a long-term basis how much real estate goes up. Great article in, I think it was in the Wall Street Journal also, about what's going on in Austin. Did anyone read that article about what real estate in Austin has gone up higher than any other city in the US? There's no, it's just, it's crazy how it's gone up.
Well, I can give a testimony. For everyone here, maybe Claude's the only one that knows, I live in Toronto, and real estate here is out of control. Out of control. Like, people are moving hundreds and hundreds and thousands of miles away because they can't afford real estate here in Toronto.
Oh, yeah.
Like they're moving to, we have in the United States, you have states, we have provinces. People are moving to different provinces because they can't afford real estate where I live.
Yeah.
You mentioned $1 million before. I live part of the year in the Soviet Socialist Republic of Southern California. I never do politics, don't worry.
I see him.
Dr. Vibe.
Hi. Hey, Mrs. C, how are you? Always good to see you. Doing all right?
Vibe, yeah.
What will $1 million buy us in San Diego?
I don't know. A bathroom behind the Walmart.
Yeah. With not even a bidet, just a bathroom.
Wow. Wow.
I heard your voice. I had to say hi.
Always a pleasure. Thank you so much.
What are the other guys? Chop chicken liver?
I know Dr. Vibe. I know Jason. I know Ben.
We have a place to stay in Canada.
Oh, that's, yeah, Toronto.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I don't know Mike. And
that's Mr. Dunwoody.
Oh, James. What's all this stuff?
It's getting too big. I know.
Oh, yeah.
It's in honor of the Taliban, I'm sure.
The Taliban, huh?
I'll take over now.
Thank you, please.
It'll be wine with Claudia. Forget the beer with Claudia. Forget that.
So what about success? That was a great, or was it wealth or success?
Wealth.
What's your guys? Let's go around. What do you guys? What's your definition of wealth for you personally? It's a great question.
I don't really have. There's not a number for me. It's more, I'm probably leaning more toward just being debt free, and then not having to. I want to go do something or purchase something, not really having to stress about it. Okay, that's where I'd like to go and go there. Yeah. You know, or if I see something, I'd like to be able to at least be able to comfortably consider purchasing it, you know?
You know, when I felt
so it's not really a number. It's not really a dollar amount number for me.
It's a feeling. That's just a great point. And I remember feeling successful. Claudia goes to me, this is last year, in fact, and she said, the washing machine broke. It was 20 years older. And I said, honey, call up the local appliance, buy another washing machine. I don't care. Because I know the money's there, put it on a card, we'll pay it off in three. And, you know, there was a time in my life when, you know, something breaks expensive like that. Mm-hmm. Oh, where are we going to get the money from? What card should we use? You know, should we call up your mother and borrow the money? And to be able to just say, we've got it, just buy it. You know, that's, I agree with you, Jason. That's a good feeling.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's a good feeling,
If you're tired of the Acura, you can go get another Acura or whatever car you like. But
yeah,
you never have to worry about, you know, hey, I want to go get this, or you know, I'd like to move here, you know, within reason. Just not having to worry about it.
Not having
day to day expenses. Yeah.
Isn't that the best feeling? Not having to worry about payments and bills.
We're getting there.
How much stress do we impose on ourselves by all this materialism? Oh, I've got to get a big screen TV in every room, man. You know. Do we? You know what's another thing, Dr. Vibe? The older I get, the less materialistic I become.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
Same here.
You know? I had an uncle when he'd had a successful career as a recording artist, 60s and 70s. And when he turned 50, he said to me, he goes, you know, you get to be about this age, Ben, and you just want shit that works. You know, friendships and cars and places to live that make sense.
That's good stuff.
Yeah.
Mike, what do you think? And then we'll go to Mr. Dunwoody. Mike Davis. Yeah.
Are we talking like wealth financially or just wealth? Like whatever.
You define it. It's your definition.
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, like wealth is, you know, I think somebody said it, like freedom. You know, just having the freedom to, you know, be around my family, having the freedom to not worry about money. I don't really necessarily think it's a number, but you know, I'm young. I'm 29, right? And I live down here in California. Just a quick intro, you know, who I am, because I know nobody here knows me, but I work with Brian now and with Prop Daddy. He was going to intro us, but, you know, it just didn't happen. Because of that, I'm learning real estate and I'm learning about finances and, you know, all that kind of stuff I wasn't really, you know, appreciative of. And my idea of wealth before was just a certain amount of money, like, you know, I want $1 million or 10 million or something like that. But really understanding, you know, like, what kind of value you bring to the world. And, you know, that value can come in the form of your health, making sure that you're able to be around and, you know, be consistent with people, like your value and, you know, add joy to other people's lives and stuff like that. A lot of that stuff, you know, solving problems, you find the biggest problem, you make the most money, like me understanding and appreciating how finance is around that. It's like, for me, wealth is just freedom, you know what I'm saying? Like being able to, like you said, go to sleep, not worry about any money. You know, be able to wake up and, you know, if I want to see somebody, I can go see somebody and not worry about trying to, oh, I don't have time because I got too much going on. You know what I mean? You know, it's just, for me, it's just waking up, you know, blissful. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's more so welcome.
James, what do you think? James is a very successful real estate rehabber investor. I'd like to hear what you got to say about that topic.
Mine is pretty much, I mean, some of the people have said it too, but it's just like the freedom, you know, freedom to be able to do what I want, when I want, be able to buy what I want, go, you know, pick up and leave in the morning and go to Hawaii for 2 weeks or do whatever, you know? So, I mean, a lot of that I can already do, but, you know, the biggest thing for me too is just having, which this is the part I don't have yet, but it's having enough passive income coming in each month where I don't have to do any work whatsoever and I can still afford to do all those things that I want to do. So.
The freedom to do what you want to do when you want to do it and to have the good health during that whole thing. If you had a choice between $1 million and being healthy to your last day, which would you choose?
Health, absolutely.
Yeah. For sure.
Absolutely. Feeling good all the time.
Yeah.
You know, we see other people who are not in good health sometimes, especially with this pandemic, and we're all hearing anecdotal stories about, I've just heard a lot of nasty stories about with this, not to get into the pandemic thing, but a lot of stuff with this Delta lately. People getting sick. I have one client, a young man who got sick from the Delta, and he had the vaccination and everything, and he's quarantined now and everything. And it was not, the way he described it, it was not a pleasant experience. Even though he's young, he's healthy, and he's had the vaccination, he did not feel good. You know, good health, how important is it?
Yeah.
Everything.
It's everything.
Yeah. And Mr. D.D. DeShields, where are you? Disneyland? Where are you, sir?
I'm on the bay in Maryland.
I didn't hear him.
On the bay somewhere. Yeah, on the bay.
What, Chesapeake Bay?
Chesapeake Bay?
No, in Maryland. On the bay in Maryland. Chesapeake City, Maryland.
Okay. You know, best food ever in Maryland. They get those blue crabs. Do you ever go to one of these little crab stop? And they put the newspaper down and they give you a little hammer and a pitcher of beer. It's all peppered, these crabs. So your lips and fingers and everything burned for days. And it's the best meal you'll ever have. You'll love it.
Old Bay.
Fresh capital of the world. That's right.
Old Bay. Oh, yeah. Dr. Vibe, when are you on? How do we find you? Because you have
I guess the regular times I'm on. I host a commentary with two ladies. They give their takes on what's going on in your country on Saturday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern time. And then Sunday afternoons, I host a conversation about Black Canadians and various times throughout the week. But I appreciate you allowing me to ask that question, Claude. I really enjoyed what I was hearing, feedback and giving me some clarity and further enhance my ideas on wealth.
Yeah. Wealth. Mr. DeShields, what's wealth mean to you?
Freedom.
Mm-hmm. One word answer. I love that.
Yeah.
Freedom.
Freedom. Best answer is sometimes the smallest, the shortest one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's and would you rather have a business that gives you that freedom and you can work at that business and always know you can make more money with that business? Or would you rather just have that one winning lottery ticket?
The business.
Business. Interesting answer. You guys surprised me. I didn't think I was going to get that answer.
Business or having the skill for salesmanship.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. Something wonderful about having your own kitchen table business, you know? And today, is it easier today than it's ever been? I think so. We've got the technology.
You got a computer in your hand.
I call it the remote control to the universe. The only problem I see with a lot of budding entrepreneurs is they have lost the ability to communicate, which Dr. Vibe and you fellas in this room do so well. Okay. We have lost, I think we're it scares me for the younger kids because they're so focused on texting and emailing as their social interaction.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if that's going to, I'm not wondering. I believe it's going to hurt them. I think you need that one-on-one, that direct communication. What do you guys think?
Claude, can I just jump here? And you're talking about wins. So just want to share. One of the things I'm very passionate about is I spend a lot of time helping and mentoring fathers and men. And I had the opportunity 2 days this week to go to a virtual conference about engaging with low-income fathers. And there was all the presentations were incredible, but this one gentleman gave an hour presentation that was absolutely fabulous. It just really, really hit me. So what did I do? I sent him a video message and I thanked him on how powerful his communication was and how I'm gonna take the things that he shared with me in my helping of fathers and men. And I put it out there, you know, I put it out there, hey, I'd love to have you on my show. And he sent me a message back. Thank you for your personal message. It really touched me. And here's my assistant's contact information. Would love to be on your show. And this guy charges thousands of dollars to do presentations. And I'm going to get some of his time through me to help others. But it was a huge win. So I agree with the communication. It wasn't giving good phone, but it was giving good video.
You asked another human being.
Yes.
All you did was ask. I don't think we ask enough.
Shoot your shot.
Take your shot at it. Go for it.
Shoot your shot.
Yeah. All day long. Just ask.
Yeah.
Just ask.
Is everybody doing the personal videos? I started to do it. It's very effective.
Ah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've heard this before. You mean you could do your own videos and create organic, compelling content that'll attract people who want to buy your services and products? That's all right. Where did you learn this?
I learned it from the master. 30 seconds personal video. I help.
So I just want to just ask, so what kind of responses are you getting back from people when you send those videos? Because I can share some of mine, but I'd like to hear some of yours.
Positive. Nobody's, as they say, hung up on me or said, please don't do that again, or I don't understand what you're talking about.
Yeah.
It's a straight shot. It delivers.
There you go.
I got a new client from Monrovia. I think I said it right. I don't even know where Monrovia is. I had to look it up.
Monrovia.
Outside of LA County.
It's in Europe. It's the one in Europe.
It's a country in Europe.
Yeah,
it's
a real one. Yeah.
All right. And this wonderful young fellow was watching my videos, and he went to my webpage to get something for free. I always offer incentives. Then he scheduled with me. Then he talked. Boom.
Is that the gentleman that was on the last Monday call? The
young fellow.
There you go.
Young fellow. And to me, that says everything about virtual attraction marketing, Ben, what you were saying. How can a guy sitting in a kitchen in North Carolina attract a client in a country that's, I think it's near Romania or something, mm-hmm. attached by Romania and all the Slavias and things like that. But think about it. And the majority of my clients are from the US, Canada, and so forth. But the marketing, you know, people spend a lot of money on marketing, but maybe if we took control of our marketing, like we take control of our sales, we can have a better experience. What do you think?
Yeah.
Good for you. How many?
I've been watching, you know, since we've connected, I've been a mentee. I see what's happening for you and people in the group. Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny. Marshall McLuhan, I always misquote him. He wrote a book in the 60s. The medium is the message.
Message.
Yeah, I always say massage because I always wonder if that's what he really meant. Can he stimulate? Can he massage, finesse the media for the results he's looking for? And it was a great book. I think I read it in must have been high school or something, and. Our media is so different today than it was, God, as little as 20, 25 years ago. I mean, how different is it today?
Well, media has their agenda. They have an agenda.
What is the media today? When I was a kid, or when I first started in real estate, it was newspapers, magazines, radio, and TV.
It's in our hand. It's in our hands and our pockets. You call it the remote control of the universe. It's so different. And they say that the
I. How old is he?
There's some white hairs in here. So you can't tell because I use cheap Lady Clairol.
But
right.
they say that the average iPhone, even the first iPhones, have more. Capacity than the computers that put the first man on the moon.
Yeah.
The things that we have in our pockets. And those first computers were the size of a living room.
So there's good and bad in all that technology, isn't it? On one hand, we're so dependent on this. Okay. What happens when you go to your car to go shopping and you forgot your phone? What's that feeling of dread that we all get? Right? Oh no, I left my phone home. Oh no. I
screwed up. Yeah.
It's for me, it's really bad because I have my driver's license and credit cards inside my phone. This is a great little thing here. It's called a Silk. It's like $20 on Amazon. And it has a little pocket here. And it's just enough to hold a driver's license, a $20 bill, and a debit and credit card. It's just enough. Nice. Anybody here ever have a fat wallet? You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. I have one now. Yeah. I need to get one of those.
It's the one thing I trimmed down on. I got rid of my wallet. Used to be, there's a Seinfeld episode where George has this huge wallet and he's got rubber bands on it. You know that episode?
He starts having back problems and the whole thing. Yeah, that was a good one. Yeah. He can't even fold it, you know. He's trying to get it folded and then it starts causing back issues. Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah. So it's the market today, the marketing is podcasts like Dr. Vibe does, like Tashi does. I do YouTube videos, lot of the kids going on to TikTok and Pinterest and all the others. There's so many right now too. And there's so many different live streaming. Here we are using Zoom, and I'm recording. And well, if I wanted to hit a button, I can be simultaneously on YouTube or Facebook. And then there's StreamYard, that great technology. You can be on 30 different platforms at the same time while you're broad. Literally, you can have your own NBC, your own network cable.
Think of the power of this,
you know?
What I will say, Claude, is something I remember many years ago, the late and great artist Prince said, I think back in the 1980s, he said, make sure you control your media. Don't let the media control you.
Did you see the 60 Minutes 2 weeks ago, I think, had a whole story on Prince? He has enough music recorded to last to the 22nd century.
Yeah, but there's a bad side about, well, there are some bad sides. Unfortunately, people may or may not know, he died without a will.
Yeah, he did.
How does that happen? A guy that's smart, that creative, that much money, and he doesn't have a lawyer to make a will?
Yeah. Well, there's too many people that are dying with a bill, not a will. I'll leave it at that.
Artists are a different breed. They really are. My mother did business management in Hollywood for a while, and Marlon Brando, he didn't want to go anywhere where he couldn't sign. If they didn't know him and allow him to sign, he wasn't doing business there. He refused to do credit cards. He refused to take cash.
When you say sign, you mean sign a send me a bill kind of thing?
Yeah, give him an account or let him sign a cocktail napkin. Whatever, you know.
There's a great story about Picasso, Pablo Picasso, the famous cubist, artist, and he did the same thing. He'd go to a restaurant, and he said, "Well, I can pay for it, or I can draw you a picture on a napkin. Which would you prefer?" There's a lot of Picasso napkins out there with his little drawings, and he'd do a little squiggly with a sideways face, you know. Or something like that. Imagine being that popular that you could do a doodle on a napkin and the bill is taken care of.
Sure, they could take that napkin and turn it to an NFT or something.
What would that napkin, look it up, by the way, it's in Google. There's great stories about how he used to go to these restaurants and just go and say, draw you something real fast, you know, no bill.
There are also a few artists who believe they shouldn't pay, that they are gifting you by patronizing your establishment. They are notoriously cheap and belligerent about the bill. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Snobby people are like that, period. Like, I mean, you can find that, and I know for sure a lot of vain artists, because they get a lot of the fame. And actually, some of it is technically like free marketing for that establishment if they, you know, they're in. You know, see some of that, but yeah, I think just snobby people they're gonna be like that.
I actually feel sorry for famous people. Okay, yeah, they have the wealth, they got everybody loves them, everybody wants their autograph and everything. I think there's something wonderful about going with your special lady to a restaurant, having a glass of wine, and no one bothers you.
Right.
Sorry for them. They can't do that, can they?
No privacy. No privacy.
What's that word?
Not the same.
You know, and maybe you need security, or maybe you have to worry about kidnapping from family members and things like that. And you know, is fame necessarily something who said, Andy Warhol? Oh God, I got a brain cell. It's working time. Andy Warhol said the famous, everybody should get 15 minutes of fame.
Yeah. Or
something to that effect. Who remembers the exact quote? What was it, Dr. Vibe?
I think it was you. I think you had it right. Everyone wants their 15 minutes of fame, but these days it's 15 seconds of fame.
Today, can we market ourselves to our little niche, micro niche audience, and have maybe some recognition or make new friends or find new customers? Can we, you know, do we need to have the whole world acknowledge us, or maybe just that little slice of the pie?
Yeah, I'd rather the slice of the pie for sure.
Slice of the pie.
Yeah.
You can get the money, not the fame. That'd be perfect. Cause I've been working like the music industry, and like I've had, you know, opportunities where like songs have gone, you know, like major or movies viral and stuff like that. And you just see a different side of people when they recognize that you're responsible for it. And it's like, bro, you don't even treat me like that on a regular basis. Why are you acting so corny? You know what I mean? Or like, you know, you when you interact with people, they treat you differently. But it's like, if I didn't have this, how would you treat me? Mm-hmm. And, you know, likewise, what is your perception of me to where I can't actually have a normal interaction or get normal daily things done? Sorry. Get normal daily things done without somebody, you know, looking at me crazy. You know what I mean? And I've never been famous or anything like that. I don't want that. I'm scared of it. I've seen a little bit of, you know, attention, and it's like, I don't, just give me the money, not the fame. I want the freedom to be around. Like you said, go to the bar, get a glass of wine and chill.
Remind me of a story. We're in New York City, Claudia and I, and my daughter, Rebecca, she's a little thing, 5 years, 6 years old.
Thing. She was a daughter, a child.
My child.
Not a thing.
My thing. And, so, you know, being married is like a ventriloquist act, and you know where the hand goes, but.
Do you call your kids things?
Okay, well, think. Well, oh, wait, he's banned.
It's a term of endearment, though.
Right, I'm going to call her now and tell her that.
So we're in New York City. Yeah. We're in an elevator, the three of us, and in walks Carol Channing.
Oh, yes.
Sure.
Okay. And she loved my daughter instantly, and and we knew who it was. And I didn't want to bother the lady, but she interacted with us, the sign of a really secure, famous person, you know, really nice, really nice. It's my only famous person story.
But it was a nice story because she just was a very sweet lady talking to us and engaging our 5-year-old daughter. It was really sweet. Yeah. Really, really sweet.
It's interesting, both of you mentioned that I've been blessed to be around sort of stars, and they don't want you to talk about what they have to talk to. They just like treat them like normal human beings. They appreciate those conversations because they always have to have, for lack of a term, their game face on.
Right.
And just, they really appreciate just coming at them like they're just normal human beings.
Well, we used to go
Did she sing Hello Dolly to you?
Yes, she did.
We used to go to a bookstore in La Jolla when my children were small.
Yeah.
And they always had authors come and sign books and so on.
Yeah.
And Captain Kangaroo.
Oh, my.
You remember him, right, Dr. Vibe?
Yep. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
You know that he was the Marine in World War II? Can you picture it?
I would believe that. I really would. He was a wonderful man. And my daughter, it was so funny because Becca didn't know who Captain Kangaroo was. It made me feel so bad. I felt like a bad mother. Oh, but we went and we met him and we got a book from him and we just chatted. He was the most wonderful guy, down to earth, was telling us about his family, his daughters, I mean, an absolute, you know, what you loved for him, you loved him on television. I'll tell you what, you loved him in person. He was just a good, nice man.
Who's the most famous person you ever met? Let's go around the room. Has everyone here met one famous person?
Yeah. Mr. Green Jeans.
Yeah, absolutely. I've been real fortunate. Yeah, I met Captain Kangaroo when I was a kid in Baltimore. But I met Ralph Bronner, whose father founded Dr. Bronner's Castile Soap.
Oh my God! Really,
yeah. We hung out and played guitar. I met him at a natural food expo in Baltimore.
Wow!
In the late '90s, and we went back to his. Him and his wife and some of his daughters and family were there. We went back and he gave me a songbook and we played. I played guitar. We played guitar and sang old folk, like Woody Guthrie, like folk favorites. This Land Is Your Land and that type of stuff. Oh, beautiful, you know, and for hours. And it was, I'll never forget it. Yeah.
Famous person you've ever met. Let's go around the room. Or would like to meet
Claude, the mentor of Diamond.
That was David Skolnick. David, you and I have shared enough In-N-Out burgers already.
I thought I recognized that voice.
Hey, yeah, David. But you ran him off and I haven't.
I'm thinking Ringo Starr.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. A Beatle.
Yeah.
Cool.
What was it like? How'd you meet him?
Oh, he was fantastic. I was I worked for a big catering outfit. It was just a summertime commitment, and that outfit, they had contracts with large venues. We did Beyonce and Adele, you know, a week at a time, Rose Bowl Staples. But this was at the Greek Theater in Los Angeles, and it was Ringo's all-star band. So, I mean, everybody.
Yeah. Who was in that band? Who was in that band?
Todd Rundgren and.
Wow.
I can't just a who's who, but he was a joy, a pleasure all season. And they didn't have any of that pretentiousness. They came in bands with their families and their kids, and they didn't sweat a thing. You know what I mean? And they put on a great show. And then they went home, you know what I mean? Business as usual with them. Yeah. Neat.
Mr. Shields, who's the most famous
person? I met Fat Elvis in Vegas, but I'm not sure if it was the real one.
There's a lot of Elvises. There's a lot of Elvises.
Sorry, I'm just enjoying being on with you for beer once
it's okay. You know, you're
in a lifetime because I'm usually at work around this time.
Yeah. Your video's off, Dave.
So's my shirt, and I don't want to share.
favorite little story about famous person who's just a good human being was Katrina. When was that? How long ago was Katrina? Yeah.
2003, four, something like 2003, that.
2003, and Brian Wilson Beach Boys had on his webpage, "I'm trying to raise money for people in Katrina," just a good guy. And so I went in there, I made a donation, and he said, I'll call your home and talk to you for a few minutes if you make a donation to help the folks in Katrina. And I knew it was Claudia's birthday. And what do you marry the woman who has me, you know? Oh, I mean, God. What do you buy? What gift do you give that woman?
Oh, so, my God.
Anyway, Brian Wilson called up. Of course, she's in the bathroom or something. And he says, "Hi, this is Brian Wilson." I said, "Oh, my God, he really did call me."
Real Brian Wilson.
And he said, and the guy who did Good Vibrations and all these, one of the
genius.
I mean, and he called up and sang happy birthday to Claudia. You know,
and nice. I thought, and we've got it recorded. We've got
nice, nice.
I'll pull it out someday. But I love famous, unique people who are so nice and down to earth, just real people, you know? Because you hear all the other junk about people all the time, but I think people are people. How about you, Mr. Davis?
Any experience
to Miles Davis?
Nah. I like jazz music though, but nah. No relation. But one person that sticks out to me is his name is Young Guru. He's Jay-Z's main engineer.
Right.
Cool as a fan. I got to meet him a couple of times. First time he was at a producer and engineer, like kind of thing that the Grammys, they hold like it's kind of like a meetup basically, but it's like a big meetup where, you know, just a lot of like minds and, you know, can exchange ideas and things. And just listening to him, like somebody his stature and, you know, all of the people that he's met, you could see just how real he is and authentic. And he's, you know, he's not pretending. You can just walk up to him, you know, just say what's up, chop the shit. Like, you know, that's not really, you feeling intimidated at all. You can just be yourself. So like you said, people that, you know, there are people, you know, that have reached the heights that, you know, they still people, you know what I'm saying? I always appreciate that.
It's great. Anybody else? Mr. Dr. Vibe, who'd you meet?
Well, there've been a few, I guess. There's a lady, probably not too many people would know, but it was a singer named Kate Bush.
Mm-hmm. Kate Bush. That sounds so familiar.
And many years ago, I used to work at a restaurant, and it was right beside the head office of Canada's National Video Music Channel. and there would be people that come in from the station, and I developed a relationship with this gentleman, and a lot of artists that would come through town and say, hey, would you like to meet them? So I was a real big fan of Kate Bush, and she was coming into town. He said, well, come on into the station and see if we can meet her. And I basically had a chance to just sit with her one-on-one for an hour and just have a conversation with her, and didn't talk anything about music or anything like that. And beautiful lady. Right. Like, I know she's a little bit older now, but really beautiful lady. But I didn't say ask anything about music. We just talked about life goals and things like that. It was a really incredible, she signed a poster, autographed a poster of mine. Another gentleman I had a chance to meet briefly was, why am I forgetting his name? Will Smith.
Oh my gosh, the Prince of Bel-Air.
He came 1 year, him and his wife came up 1 year to debut a movie that they were involved in about, it's a biography about Angela Davis.
Sure.
And we had a chat, and then I only had a small chat with him for about 5 minutes, but then his assistant and I had a conversation. His assistant actually took me to a restaurant and we chatted for an hour, and I had a chance to find out Will Smith's thought process, because I love, if I get the opportunity around famous people, I want to find out their thought process. What makes them think? What keeps them go? Like, you know, I don't necessarily want what they have. I want what they know, their knowledge and how I can apply it. So if I ever meet people who are famous, I want to see if I can get them relaxed and just listen to them talk and find out through what they say, their fundamentals of success, you know, and any nuggets they have to drop in those times.
One of the best business touching movies I've ever seen. You know where I'm going to go here.
Yes, saw that. Chris Gartner, and I had a chance to meet him too.
The Pursuit of Happiness. Has everybody here seen this movie?
Great movie.
It is just a great, I love the way he takes care of his son, the way he's so hungry for success and while still taking care of his son. I mean, it's a powerful movie.
Sure is.
Locked in the bathroom.
And it's not a slick movie. It doesn't have a lot of special effects or anything. It's just a good actors with a good script, you know?
Mm-hmm. Great message.
Oh, it's a super. Mm-hmm. And then at the end, when he's working so hard and he gets the sale, and then they hire him and he gets the job so he can take care of his son and everything. I mean, that's a, you know, that's a boohoo tissue moment, you know. it's a great business movie.
Did you pack those from Colorado or
Dave? All you need is a box of tissues and a Sharpie, Dave. It's not that hard.
It's a high tech business.
Got tissues.
Well, gentlemen, it is Din-Tin time over here in the Aaron's household. My mother-in-law is home. And this was fun. Thank you so much for coming on spontaneously and sharing your stories and insights and everything. Dr. Vibe, one more time, where do we find you? What's the easy?
Best place is to go to thedrvibeshow.com, the Dr. Vibe Show. And gentlemen, thank you for sharing. And Claude, as always, Claude and I go back a bit because he was the first we go back to a plot. What's the name of that plot? Blab. Anyone remembers the platform Blab, I remember that Friday night, the first time I came on Blab, and the first person I interacted with was Claude, and we had a conversation.
And we had a fun conversation.
Every time. So I'm not in real estate, but I've learned a lot from Claude Diamond, and I share whatever I learn with him with anyone I encounter. And of course, cannot forget the better half.
Seriously, Dr. Vibe, that's very sweet of you to say, though, about Claude. Seriously, I mean,
I truly, really, I've learned so much, and I never take it for granted when he invites me into these conversations. So thank you with much respect.
Who initiated the conversation?
Dr. Vibe, but he had the Blab broadcast.
I initiated, but I always learn from him. And I even up to yesterday, I was speaking with someone and gave the line, give good phone. A lot of people need to do that, whether it's good video phone or good phone. People are inundated by emails. They want to be, they want that personal touch.
Yeah.
He's got that, he's got that copyrighted. You got to pay him a quarter every time you say it.
That's all right. I'll convert my Canadian money to US quarters, my Canadian quarters into US quarters for him.
How is the Canadian, last question, how is the Canadian dollar right now? Is it strong again?
It's getting strong again. Obviously, it slid a little bit, but right now it's in a little bit indecisive because we have an election right now going on national.
Are you going to reelect that young guy?
I have to see his platform. Whenever a politician comes to me and say, okay, what are you doing about this? And if they can't answer, say, sorry, can't give you my vote.
Good for you. Good for you. Gentlemen, thank you. Always a pleasure. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. Be safe. And thanks for joining us. Take care.
Thanks, Claude. Be safe, everyone.
Yeah. Be safe.
See you on Monday.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Monday.